which well, it's a very reliable partner that I always work with. But anyway, so that kind of a very highly demanding diplomatic events, and can go on the air like that. And another example that I have in my handout today is that the one that I did after, well, no, actually, this was actually before, but President Obama did come to Tokyo for the summit meeting in Iseshima. And of course, the Hiroshima speech was after the summit meeting, but before the summit meeting, after President Obama arrived in Tokyo, he had a press conference with Prime Minister Abe. And that was broadcast from Iseshima Hotel, Iseshima Kanko Hotel. And that was broadcast actually from Mie Prefecture. And on the spot, a very, very interesting thing happened, which does not happen very often. And this was very intriguing to me as a researcher, was that there was simultaneous interpreting, which I and another colleague of mine provided on NHK. We did not move from Tokyo. We were sitting in NHK's interpreting booth. So we were doing the simultaneous interpreting for the press conference. But what happened was, it was apparently, I think there was no simultaneous interpreting equipment on spot at Iseshima Kanko Hotel. So there were consecutive interpreting provided there by, I think I know who they are, who provided the simultaneous interpreting. One is from American Embassy, the other one is from Foreign Ministry from Japan, who usually interprets for Prime Minister Abe. And that interpreter did Japanese into English, you know, who regularly interprets for Prime Minister Abe. But then the other one, President Obama's speech was interpreted by, I think this is an interpreter from American Embassy in Japan, in Tokyo, that provided the consecutive interpreting. So we were in a very awkward situation, you know, since we were doing simultaneous in NHK, and my colleagues were also doing into English as well. And I and another colleague, we were doing into Japanese. But what happens is, every time we do the simultaneous interpreting, there is consecutive interpreting after that. So we asked the NHK at that time, do you really want to convey this with simultaneous interpreting? But they said, yes, we do. So we continued like that. But that was a very rare occasion that we can hear both the consecutive interpreting and the simultaneous interpreting. Another rare occasion that I experienced that was after the Rugby World Cup in UK. The Japanese rugby team did a very good job there, and the head coach, Eddie Jones, was interviewed after he came back to Japan with the rugby team. And I was called to do the interpreting there, and the same thing happened. There is his interpreter who did interpret consecutively, but there I was interpreting simultaneously, and it was very awkward because there's, you know, always the consecutive interpreting that followed after that. So these are, I think, the only two occasions I had that we both had the simultaneous and the consecutive. But sometimes these things do happen because I did mention Academy Awards, that always is carried live, simultaneous interpreting, and major sports events like hero interview after a major game. For example, tennis player Nishikori did give interview in English, so I did do a simultaneous interpreting on news on that occasion as well. So sometimes major sports events we are called to do that. Okay, before I go on, let me just show you what actually happens in this press conference by Chief Cabinet Secretary, I think it might be useful if you remember this site, because not too many people might not know about this, but every day there are two press conferences by the Chief Cabinet Secretary that is conveyed in Japanese, of course, but for the foreign media, this is with Japanese into English, simultaneous interpreting. This is not my voice, since I was already here yesterday, but this is the newest news conference by Chief Cabinet Secretary, but this I sometimes do. There's no mention of the name of the interpreter here, but you can hear the entire thing with the interpreter's voice. So you might,
okay,
I let you listen to this.
First of all, about Typhoon Lionbrook, at this moment, we know there have been 11 casualties, one unaccounted for, of 13 who has been, four that has been hurt. In Hokkaido, there has been a bridge that has collapsed, and so a car fell into the flood. And so there are two cases where we're still trying to identify a person missing. Rescue operation is still underway, and we're trying to pay our fullest attention in grasping the entire damage. And also, Iwaizumi Cho and Kuji Cho in Iwate Prefecture, there has been some damaged roads, and so SDF members, police department, fire department personnel are trying to help the people there, as well as to help the livelihood of the people, including offering necessary aids and water. Also, yesterday in Iwate Prefecture, Mr. Mukdai has been leading the task force team of the government. And the communication between the Iwate governor has been made, and looking into the damaged area is under its schedule. Also, Mr. Matsumoto will be attending a meeting this afternoon to hold the disaster measures meeting by the government. We'd like to make sure we pay out all out efforts so that we'd be able to grasp the entire view of the damage and also be able to go into implementing necessary measures. Tomorrow.
Okay, let me skip a little bit and show you what happens when press asks questions. Okay.
All right. As a state minister, but when is this going to be done? Is it going to be from